I'm here with Mark, the owner of Mazworx, and Mazworx are the builders of their S15 SR20 powered drag car. It's recently run a 650 and as fast as 221 mile an hour on the quarter. Now this makes it the second fastest four-cylinder drag car in the world, and it's run that time and that mile an hour after only a handful of passes after a complete rebuild. So this is obviously pretty promising and bodes well for that S15 to take that world record in the not too distant future. So Mark, I just wanted to spend some time talking about some of the technology that's going into the engines that you at Mazworx are building. You're well known for your billet blocks in particular. We're seeing a trend all around the world with a lot of engines or high-powered engines are now moving away from a factory cast block towards those billet blocks. Can you tell us for a start, where do you see some of the limitations in the factory cast blocks, particularly if we talk about the SR20 and maybe the Toyota 2JZ as examples?
Okay, well, the biggest difference is that you got one's a cast aluminum and one's cast iron. With the cast aluminum blocks, they tend not to crack instantly, but you'll definitely see like the line bore and the block actually moving around under high horsepower, and eventually it will crack. It's mainly the link between the head stud and the main stud is, if the block does crack, that's where you'll see it.
So you're actually talking about the block essentially cracking through the center?
Yes, like horizontally between the link between the head stud and the main stud. Now with the 2Js and with the cast iron blocks, they'll handle more horsepower. You won't see much of the block dancing around because it's cast iron, but when it yields, it just ends up cracking.
Now, even before these blocks fail, okay, obviously we are talking two very different materials, cast aluminium or cast iron, but in both situations, even before the blocks actually fail, is it fair to say you're likely to see at high boost levels, high power levels, are the cylinders distorting and hence affecting the power the engine's producing anyway?
Well, we will see the in a cast aluminum blocks, we will see the cylinders start ovaling. You'll see that. You'll start seeing the main caps getting really loose. You know, you unbolt it and they'll fall out instead of being pressed in. If they're doweled or if they're pressed in, you'll see that happening. Now, as far as them ovaling, you can make them round again. We've noticed, especially with putting the torque plates on them, you'll see a lot of effect with that. Initially, it ovaling, and when we hone them, they'll come out round again. So you see that.
So when you've gone to the billet block, when you're actually designing a billet block to replace a factory cast block, what sort of design elements are you adding into the billet block? Obviously, you've got the ability to essentially do anything you want. You're starting with a solid block of aluminium and machining that. So what design considerations are you adding in to improve the strength in a very high horsepower drag application?
Well, first we'll analyze what's failing on the factory block and we'll concentrate on that. If you see like cast iron blocks, they're iron, but if you cut them in half, they're really thin iron. And with the aluminum, they'll be thicker, but it'll be a porous cast aluminum. So the biggest design consideration we take is the link between the head stud and the main stud. If we concentrate on that link and make that stronger, then it really has no place to fail. Now, as far as the cylinders keeping shape, we'll concentrate on putting more material around the cylinders and holding the sleeve. We not necessarily will make a thick sleeve because the sleeve will hold the shape as long as the backing is strong enough to hold it.
Yeah, I see that you're using Darton sleeves in your billet blocks, and you've got the option there for dry and wet sleeve design. So can you talk to us a little bit about those differences, where you'd choose one over the other?
Well, initially when we started designing the blocks, we did like a pro drag block to where we designed it for the high horsepower methanol drag race motor. So putting water in a block wasn't really a consideration. Well, a couple years later, we had a lot of customers asking about wet blocks. So then we kind of reevaluated what kind of blocks we needed. So we came out with like a pro street version where it's mainly a carbon copy of the factory block where you can run your factory oil pump. And of course, we needed water through the sleeves. And the good thing about Darton is a lot of these blocks already come with an MID sleeve. So we can use off-the-shelf sleeves for those billet blocks. Now with the case of the 2J, we're working on designing a wet block for the 2J, so we're gonna have to develop in line with Darton an MID sleeve for the 2J.
So at the moment that's not a product that Darton offer for the 2J?
I'm sorry?
The MID sleeve is not a product that they offer for the 2J?
Not yet. We've already talked with them and making those is not a problem, but it'll be, only one application would be for us.
And now, one of the advantages, as I understand it, with using the sleeves, the MID sleeves, is if you do in use end up damaging one cylinder, maybe you have a lean out, maybe it nips up or something in one particular cylinder, you can replace individual sleeves?
Yes, that's correct. The MID sleeves have the O-rings on the bottom. They're easy to take out and easy to reinstall and just remachine it, the new sleeve.
Now, one of the other common problems we see with very high boost import drag engines is the limiting factor often becomes that gasket seal between the cylinder head and the block. So how are you addressing that? What are the technologies you're using there to improve that seal?
Well, there's many different ways. So many people out there have their own little tricks. For the high boost, the drag race motors right now, we just do a standard stainless O-ring in the head, a receiver in the block, and a copper gasket. I see guys do it the other way. The biggest reason why you want to put the O-ring in the head is because the receiver groove, you want to put the receiver groove in the iron and it keeps the sharp edges. If you end up doing the other way around, you put the receiver in the head, the sharp edges in the receiver end up getting smooshed in. So putting the O-ring in the head seems to be the best. Now, as far as trying to do keeping the water, we've had a couple customers out there try using the copper head gasket with the water flow, and it seems to be working out pretty good. You might get leaks here and there with the MLS head gaskets. There's a couple different theories on that. When we install the sleeves, we actually do a step deck process where we leave the sleeve, you know, 3, 4, 5 thou proud of the block, so that helps concentrate the sealing around the cylinder when you clamp it on there. There's a couple different head gaskets out there. You know, you got the grommet style head gaskets that actually have a sealing ring around the cylinders, and that helps out a lot. There's fat OEM head gaskets that are just strict multi-layer. In that case, you know, you put a copper O-ring in the sleeve to help out. So there's a couple different theories, and you know, shops out there doing different things, but that's kind of what we do.
And a little bit application specific, I guess, as well.
Yeah.
In terms of drag versus high performance street?
Yeah, high performance street, we stick with the metal head gaskets. We try to work with that because if you do have problems, you know, it's easy to repair. The copper head gaskets, if you torch the head or something, you need to remachine a head, then you got to do the O-ring over again, and it's a more of a lengthy process.
In terms of the studs that you're using as well, I'm assuming that you're also stepping up the size of those studs, again, being that you're using a billet material, you can do whatever you want. Is that a big necessity when you're trying to hold in that additional boost?
Yeah, when we first started the blocks, the billet blocks, we went like an off-the-shelf ARP half-inch stud, and they've been pretty successful to a limit. And we have a lot of races out there that requesting like an L19 stud. So we ended up finding a top fuel stud. It's a 9/16 bottom with a half-inch shank that we've been using for most of the guys. And you can torque those up to 135, 150 pounds without a problem. But then in that case, we're still running a factory cast head, so you got to pay attention to how much you're going to squish the head. You know, if you want to torque the head down to 150 foot-pounds, if you're squishing the head, then it's not really making that much of an effect.
That was the next thing I was actually going to comment on there, both with the protrusion of the liners of those sleeves as well as the amount of torque you use. So there is a point where more torque is not necessarily better. You actually start distorting the cylinder head.
Yes, that's correct. Well, with the protrusion of the sleeve, we know that aluminum and even cast aluminum will deflect. So it's going to... You know, when we model things like as if they're a spring, because everything has a modulus of elasticity. So when we clamp the head on the block, it actually deforms around. The head will deform and the block will deform a little bit, and the sleeve will not deform as much. But that's where we get the extra clamping force around the cylinder. And like you said, if you over-torque it, you're just smashing the head, maybe unseating the valves. You know, you're going backwards.
Now, just to talk about a few of the specific aspects with the S15 drag car. Now, it's running the SR20 VE cylinder head, quite a popular option for anyone who wants to make a lot of horsepower with an SR20. Now, one of the aspects with the heads, and this really isn't specific to the SR20, is the squish area or squish pads in the cylinder head. I know there's two schools of thought on the squish pads. The idea behind them initially is that as the piston comes towards TDC, those squish pads help push the combustion charge in towards the spark plug. The idea there is to help reduce detonation. Other school of thought that in a modified application they can actually promote detonation and even pre-ignition. So what's your thoughts on that, and what are you doing with those?
Well, we started taking those out back in the 90s with the lower octane fuel, and with the SR20s, when we started building the motors, when the customers bring them in, they have detonation issues. First place we see it is in the squish areas. So what we would do is, okay, well, let's let's take them out. And we took them out and it stopped detonating. So that was the first reason why we did it. But after looking at it, the SR20 guys, we started running thicker head gaskets. So your squish area ended up being less effective because you had more space there. So it came more of a localized combustion chamber, and that's why it started detonating. I think with the thinner head gaskets and getting the piston closer to the squish area, yeah, I think it'll have a better effect, you know, like a pent roof style combustion chamber, like a 2J, you know, forcing that mixture up in the combustion chamber.
So I think that comes back to, I think there's an old school idea when you turbocharge a naturally aspirated engine with a high compression ratio, a lot of people would fit a thicker head gasket in. While yes, that will drop the compression ratio, but the reduction in that squish effect actually can almost end up in the same place in terms of the engine's likelihood to detonate.
Yes, that's correct. And you know, it's in some of those engines, like I was saying, that the 2J, even the Honda B series, where you don't have the room to take the squish areas out, you got to do what you got to do.
Now, in terms of removing those squish areas, you're also going to a bigger bore diameter. That also has an improvement on the flow around the valves. You've got the ability to deshroud those as well?
Yes. With the SR20, we go to the Darton Sleeves. We have the capability going from 86mm bore to a 90mm bore. So what we would do is we would CNC the chamber, take out the squish areas, and actually open up the chamber to a 90mm. And we've noticed on the flow bench is that actually helps us increase the airflow capability of the motor.
Now, a lot of people aren't doing that. They aren't modifying those combustion chambers when they do step to a larger bore diameter. So obviously that's going to introduce a step as you come into the combustion chamber. How detrimental is that to the engine's performance?
Well, we haven't really done any back-to-back testing, but it increases your squish area if you're not taking that out. And I'm sure, as you can see, in the SR20s, it'll start detonating farther in.
Now, in terms of removing that squish area as well, machining that out of the head, what sort of effect has that got on the compression ratio typically? Obviously, that's going to be somewhat engine specific, but can you give us a bit of a guide?
Well, we've noticed, like with the SR20 DETs, it take almost a full point of compression out, and with the VEs, it take about a half a point of compression out.
All right, look, Mark, it's been really interesting getting some insight into that, and certainly your billet blocks are a work of art. Also with the S15, we really look forward to seeing what that car does next year, coming into winter now, so looking forward to seeing its results coming into the new summer. And if our viewers want to find out more about your products, how can they reach out, how can they touch base with you?
Well, they can reach us on Facebook, Mazworx Manufacturing, and go to our website, Mazworx.com. They can shoot us an email at info@mazworx.com, and there's, you know, just search us on Google and you'll definitely find us.
Awesome. Thanks a lot for your time, Mark.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.